We all know that at some point, mammals went back to sea after evolving on land, because today we have things like whales, dolphins, seals. But have you ever wondered how many times that actually happened? Well, that's what we'll be talking about in today's video, and the answer might surprise you, because it did me. After fish like Tiktaalik began the transition from water to land, which I have a video on if you want to check it out, I'll link it to the top right, amphibians, reptiles, mammals, and birds evolved, which those along with fish make up the five major groups of animals that we have on Earth today. Amphibians never really fully left water, they are, you know, semi-aquatic, but all the ones that became fully terrestrial at some point had species go back to being aquatic, or at least semi-aquatic. For example, I've talked about marine reptiles in previous videos, especially those that lived in the Mesozoic around 250 to 66 million years ago, which were super cool. I mean, today we still have some aquatic reptiles like turtles, snakes, alligators, and crocodiles, but back in the Mesozoic we had ichthyosaurs, which were like this ancient reptile dolphin, and we had plesiosaurs, which were kind of like Loch Ness monsters, and then we had mosasaurs, which were like these huge, almost like whale-sized, toothed, horrible, terrifying predators that probably greatly rivaled sharks in that time as the dominant apex predators, and they're always portrayed in movies like Jurassic World and Avatar 2 as these big apex predators. And actually, I just recently watched the second Avatar, The Way of the Water, and oh my gosh, you guys, watch it with Mesozoic marine reptiles in mind, because I swear, guys, they took so much inspiration from things like mosasaurs, plesiosaurs. I mean, just watch it again if you have already seen it, or watch it if you haven't seen it with that in mind, because I was flabbergasted at how similar all of their sea creatures looked to some sort of Mesozoic, you know, sea creature that we've reconstructed. It was pretty impressive and really, really cool to see it in all like the colorful, you know, world that they created. I really enjoyed it because of that aspect. I highly recommend. Another example of a group of animals that has many species that have become semi to almost fully aquatic are birds, like penguins, gulls, albatrosses, petrels, puffins, pelicans, loons, ducks, etc. But in today's video, we will be focusing on the journey of mammals to sea. Although in the previous era, the Mesozoic era, marine reptiles kind of took over the niche that today marine mammals fill, after their extinction at the end Cretaceous extinction along with many of the dinosaurs, the Cenozoic era has been characterized by this niche in the ocean being filled by mammals instead of reptiles. But modern marine mammals do not all come from one common terrestrial ancestor. So now for the question that the video poses, how many independent times did mammals go back to sea? I originally thought it was three. Actually, at first I thought it was two, whales and dolphins, cetaceans, being one independent mammal lineage that went back to sea, as shown by kind of this evolutionary line on the bottom left. And then two, manatees, dugongs, seals, walruses, etc. And then later I learned that manatees and dugongs and seals and walruses are kind of separate independent lineages. So I was like, okay, so three times, three independent times that mammal lineages went back to sea. However, this is way off. Mammals went back to sea at least seven separate times. Five of these clades are extant, still living, and two are extinct. The first is cetacea. Obviously, this is kind of the more obvious one, whales, dolphins, porpoises. Then we have Sirenia, which includes manatees and dugongs, also nicknamed sea cows. And manatees and dugongs, by the way, are different. Who knew? I always thought they looked really similar and might be really closely related. They are within the same order, Sirenia, but they have different tail shapes, as you can see here, and apparently different mouths. Then we have Desmostylia, which is an extinct lineage of marine mammals. Then we have pinnipeds, which includes things like seals, sea lions, and walruses. Then polar bears, which I didn't even think of as like marine mammals, but they are semi-aquatic, and they're kind of alone in their little species group, Ursus maritimus. Another one similar to polar bears that's kind of alone in its little one, you know, independent lineage that has become semi-aquatic is sea otters or Enhydra lutris. And lastly, and this one blew my mind, you guys, apparently there were aquatic sloths. Like, who knew? Obviously, and unfortunately for us, aquatic sloths are extinct, so this group is no longer with us, but wouldn't that have been cool? So now I'm going to go through and talk about all of the extant groups, all of the ones still living, cetaceans, sirenians, pinnipeds, and polar bears and sea otters. So starting with whales or cetaceans, I'm going to use those terms kind of interchangeably throughout this video because pretty much all cetaceans are whales. It includes two groups, toothed whales and baleen whales, which toothed whales includes things like dolphins, porpoises, so they're all whales. In any case, cetaceans likely evolved from a group of ungulates, which is kind of crazy to think about because ungulates, when we think about ungulates today, we think of like hoofed mammals like camels and horses and giraffes, I don't know, I mean, not whales. And within this group, the closest living relatives with cetaceans are hippos. It's thought that cetacean ancestors began to venture into aquatic environments to exploit new food resources, kind of just like how Tiktaalik began to venture onto land to exploit new food. So every, you know, so often in Earth's history, things think, oh, you know, the grass is probably greener over there. Like all these other animals are competing for my food over here, but what about in there? And with time, they obviously developed many adaptations to aquatic life, like streamlined bodies, modified limbs, and changes to their senses. Now, this happened, I should, you know, clarify or disclaim here, over millions of years. People think, oh, how did that happen? How did they adapt like that? How did they evolve so quick? It wasn't that quickly. I mean, it was over tens of millions of years. And several important transitionary groups have played key roles in this transition, including pachycetids, like the genus Pachycetus here, which was around in the early Eocene, around 50 million years ago. Now, these were deer-sized ungulates with features that indicated life near water, but definitely not fully aquatic by any means. And these were some of the earliest ancestors with cetaceans after the split from the common ancestor with hippos. Then later in the early Eocene, these guys became a little bit more streamlined, a little bit more aquatic, and evolved into a group known as ambulocetids, which had webbed feet for swimming, but still had many terrestrial features. Then they became even more fully aquatic with elongated bodies, elongated limbs, and tails adapted for swimming with the group protocetids in the early to mid Eocene. Then nearing the middle to late Eocene, we had the basilosaurids representing some of the earliest fully aquatic cetaceans. These more closely resembled modern whales and had more streamlined bodies and longer tails for swimming. So then we get to the two branches of living cetaceans, but I should mention here that those that I just mentioned were just key transitionary groups. In reality, involved way more transitional species and way more intricate, tiny little minute mutations and adaptations here and there that eventually got, you know, passed down because of their beneficial traits and aquatic lifestyles and all of that stuff. So it was way more intricate and long-term than it seemed just by that summary. But that was just the key transitional species. And then we get to the two living branches, including toothed whales in the group Odontoceti, which includes sperm whales, dolphins, and porpoises, which are all a bit smaller than the larger baleen whales, which include blue whales, humpbacks, and these are filter feeders, as opposed to the toothed whales, which are predators. Their common ancestor, and when they diverged into these two branches, was likely around 35 to 40 million years ago. Now moving to when manatees and dugongs, in other words, sirenians, moved to sea. So sirenians are part of the mammal group Tethotheria, named after the Tethys Sea, near which they likely evolved. And this group includes sirenians, dugongs, and manatees, proboscidea, in other words, elephants, and desmostylia, which was one of the extinct herbivorous semi-aquatic mammal groups we talked about earlier. As you can see by this graph, there are various hypothesized relationships among this group of mammals. One idea is that the common ancestor of the three groups was semi-aquatic, and then the elephant group became fully terrestrial later on. But another idea is that Desmostylia and Sirenia invaded aquatic environments independently, which was why I included them as two separate events of mammals going back to sea in the list of seven that I mentioned earlier. This idea holds a little bit more weight because the style of aquatic locomotion in these two groups is very different, which suggests that the latter idea, meaning those two groups evolved to go back into the sea separately, makes more sense. The earliest Sirenians, like Protosiren, lived around 50 million years ago with those other early cetaceans we talked about. Over millions of years, just like it took cetaceans to evolve to be fully aquatic, these ancestors of modern Sirenians like Protosiren developed more streamlined bodies, paddle-like flippers, and herbivorous dentition to feed on aquatic vegetation. Dugongs and manatees, which are the two extant living groups of Sirenians, diverged around 35 to 25 million years ago, marking the transition to fully aquatic forms. Both of these groups are fully aquatic, and dugongs are widely distributed in the Indian and Western Pacific Oceans, and manatees are broken up depending on their distribution into the groups, the Western Indian manatee, the West African manatee, and the Amazonian manatee, which is really cool. I had no idea there were manatees in the Amazon, so that's pretty awesome. Now moving to the next major independent lineage of mammals that went back to sea in the Cenozoic, the pinnipeds. Pinnipeds are quite possibly the cutest group of marine mammals. Maybe that's just me, but I mean, look at this image of this seal. In any case, this group includes true seals, fur seals or sea lions, and walruses. So yeah, there's apparently a difference between true seals and not true seals. True seals are earless, and fur seals and sea lions have like little sticky outy ears. And so that's how you can tell the difference between true seals and not true seals. And then walruses are also a separate group. So pinnipeds are known for their adaptations to both aquatic and terrestrial life. And rather than evolving from ungulates or elephant ancestors like whales and manatees did, respectively, pinnipeds likely evolved from a common ancestor with carnivores. And like all the other groups, over millions of years, they developed streamlined bodies, flipper-like limbs, and improved diving abilities. So, you know, we can see the similarities across each of these independent lineages in terms of the aquatic adaptations they all eventually evolved. The earliest well-known pinniped was Enalliarctus, I'm sorry if I'm butchering that, which lived in the late Oligocene around 25 million years ago. And this was a small seal-like transitional form with features for both land and water. Just a few million years later, in the early Miocene around 23 million years ago, this next form, Puigila, was another important transitional species with features for both land and aquatic life. And this one seems like it has features that are awfully otter-like, and you'll see later that otters and polar bears are also kind of not related directly, but have similar lineages off from carnivore common ancestors to the pinnipeds, which also have common ancestors with carnivores. So now on to the living pinnipeds. We have these three main groups, the first being Phocidae. In any case, these include true seals like the harbor and elephant seals, and these are adapted for life in water with limited mobility on land. Then we have Otteridae, which includes the not true seals, so eared seals like sea lions and fur seals. You can see their little sticky outy ears, and that's how you can tell they're not true seals. And these are more agile on land and can rotate their hind flippers forward. And then we have the obvious ones that are easy to tell apart, the walruses, or Odobinidae, known for their very large size, prominent tusks, and unique adaptations to Arctic life. There are two major divergence events for these three groups. The first divergence in pinnipeds between the true seals and eared seals occurred around 23 million years ago in the early Miocene. Then we have the divergence between walruses and eared seals, which was more recent, from 10 to 15, or in this reconstruction, it says 18 million years ago. Like the pinnipeds, polar bears and sea otters are also semi-aquatic mammals that evolved from the order Carnivora, or carnivores. However, polar bears, sea otters, and pinnipeds all have separate terrestrial ancestors within the carnivore order, making them separate, independent lineages or events of mammals going back to sea. There is this hypothesis that suggests that maybe they all share a common ancestor, and then there's these two breakout groups between polar bears and eared seals and walruses, and then the sea otters and the true seals. But there's more support for the idea that these three groups in pinnipeds evolved from one common terrestrial ancestor, and then the polar bears and the sea otters had separate ancestors that led to their evolution to become aquatic or semi-aquatic. In this hypothesis, it's likely that sea otters evolved from terrestrial weasel-like animals or animals from the weasel family around 5 to 10 million years ago, and their aquatic adaptations include webbed feet, dense fur coats to keep them warm, and a diet of marine invertebrates like sea urchins, crabs, and mollusks. Polar bears, which are part of the bear family, Ursidae, likely evolved from brown bears in the last only 150 to 200,000 years, which seems way recent, which is really cool. And to adapt to Arctic life, polar bears developed streamlined bodies, partially webbed feet for swimming, and the ability to hunt seals. To wrap the video up, I want to point out just a couple very interesting details that we can see come out in this research when we look at the evolution of marine mammals over time. One really interesting detail is that marine mammals seem to have originated at two discrete times in the Cenozoic, despite the seven independent lineages that actually evolved. For example, around 55 million years ago, Cetacea and Sirenia originated and became semi-aquatic, and then around 35 million years ago, around the end of the Eocene, they transitioned to fully aquatic forms at around the same time that Desmostylia and pinnipeds originated and became semi-aquatic. So it seems that there were these two distinct events that favored the evolution of marine mammals. There was also a repeating trend in terms of what kicked off mammal transition to aquatic lifestyles for each of these lineages. That repeating trend was the initial evolution or adaptation to feeding in water. The two most recently evolved marine mammals, polar bears and sea otters, also spend much of their time feeding in water, and that suggests to us, because these are such recent forms of semi-aquatic mammals, that in millions of years, polar bears and sea otters might become fully aquatic, especially considering that polar bears are living in a world where more and more of their ice and their land is melting. So it actually would be really cool to see what a fully aquatic type of polar bear might look like in millions of years. So that concludes our story of the seven times that mammals decided to go back to sea, which is pretty insane that it was seven times. I mean, I wish I could find more information on aquatic sloths for you guys. Those sound just insane and awesome, and I wish those were still around. I had no idea there were aquatic sloths. In any case, I hope you guys enjoyed. As always, my references are linked down below, and if you want to check out the video on marine reptiles, which I also find very cool, I will link that up here for you guys. And with that, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you guys in the next one. Bye!